Hello to all Murcia Training School attendees. Welcome to my lecture. My name is Pınar Karagöz. I'm a professor at Middle East Technical University Computer Engineering Department. I'm sorry that I couldn't personally attend the training school. I'm hoping that you're enjoying your time there and working on wonderful projects. In my lecture, I will be talking about knowledge bases and especially how to analyze text for underground built heritage knowledge base. In our COST project, an important target is to be able to produce some toolboxes which will pass the outputs of these studies within the scope of the projects, these training schools, the working group studies, the classification of underground built heritage, the information obtained for valorization or policies. So all of these or each of these information collected and obtained information, we aim to share in the form of some toolboxes. And the knowledge base is an important component of these toolboxes. So it's a way to share the information that is collected within the scope of this project. So if you check the definition, a knowledge base is a technology used to store complex, structured and unstructured information used by a computer system. So this is the definition from Wikipedia. So it is about, as you see, collecting, organizing, retrieving and sharing knowledge. So especially it's for a specific domain. So for instance, in human resources, a knowledge base may collect and provide access to information about the training, the personnel, distributing the policies there, pay schedules and so on. So a user there, somebody working in the company may access the training programs, may search, may find the relevant information about these trainings, about the company policies, may comment sometimes on such information. As another example, for instance, in a company related with legal issues or a department of a company related with legal issues, there may be a knowledge base where all the contracts, the approval processes, policies, registrations, trademarks, they're all stored in an accessible way so that the people working in the company who wants to search for such information can access, can make search, can group, and the data, this information is presented in an organized way. Another example, which a knowledge base, which was constructed within the scope of a project similar to us, a knowledge base for city exploration. So it was about Milan, the city of Milan, and the Expo Milano. All the variety of information, the places, activities, maybe transportation facilities, all such kind of information are collected from various resources and presented in an organized and searchable, in an easy to access way. For instance, the activities, events, places were organized under some titles, under some tabs, as you see here, together with some informative visuals. And if you want to see more in-depth information, so you go, you follow the link or click on a name, click on the event, then you can get the details, more details about it. So a very basic, a straightforward way of knowledge base. So we can extend the possibilities there. So what kind of information may be available there? Typical human-generated unstructured data like text files, emails, the data from social media, websites, maybe data collected from mobile resources like text messages, or the location. This is very important, the location-related information extracted from mobile data, and communications, media like the photos, audio and video files, or some machine-generated data like scientific data from sensors, satellite imagery, digital surveillance. So they are as you see, very relevant to our case as well. So if we focus on a possible knowledge base for underground built heritage, there can be descriptions of underground built heritage, the photos, the maps, the surveys made with people on different sites, for instance, or collections of related articles. Within the scope of our project, we have wiki pages, national wiki pages are being developed. Also, other related web pages can be included as well. So social media postings, links, because we use the project team uses the social media very actively. So all the postings there, the response to these postings, these are also very important, the feedbacks, the comments. So a variety of information can be put if we have a knowledge base. So then what happens, people can be organized and they can be search, and they can be a variety of or different type of analysis can be done on such type of data. Actually, I will be talking about such things in my talk. So the first capability is a keyword search. So let's say we have as you see lots of textual data descriptions. Publications, academic publications, or the web-based information published about the UBH sites, and you want to access them. You give a keyword, and you want to access those who are related to this keyword, or very basically who include the ones that include these keywords. So very basically, so we are all familiar with keyword search. So you just type your keyword and then the result is listed to you. So on the left, right hand side of this slide, you see an example, the related articles in a knowledge base are listed, and the keywords are highlighted. So the search keyword is highlighted as well. So the basic structure behind or the basic technology, basic solution behind keyword search is information retrieval in the machine learning or in the artificial intelligence terminology. So there is an information retrieval engine, and there is a query that is sent to this engine, and this engine checks the document collection, which is indexed actually. It checks the index to access the data faster, and it identifies the components or documents in the collection who are related with your query, and they are listed to you. So some search, some intelligent search mechanism is used there. So I will not go into the details. But I'm going to show you another example that we implemented. Academic publications of the members of our COSTA action. And then we now we have a collection of articles. But as you know, there are different expertise, and there are members in our project with very different background, with different expertise, with different research areas. So the collection is kind of mixed, but there may be, common keywords. So for instance, we search for heritage, and then we see that there are 108 documents in our collection, and they are listed. So you can, we did not implement that, but you can click and then you can access the paper as well. So another thing that we implemented as a proof of concept or an experimental study is that we rank the keywords. So behind this text box, you see a chart where the keywords and the number of occurrences are given in a sorted way, in a ranked way. So one of them we checked, the second one, the second the word with the second highest number of occurrence in our collection, it was urban. So, and it was seen in 228 different articles. And then you can access these articles. So you see, this is a very straightforward way of how we can use keyword search in a knowledge base to access the data collected. My research is mostly on text, but we are not limited to text in keyword search, as you know from the search engines in that we generally use. The videos, if they are annotated with the text with some keywords, you can retrieve the pictures, photos, or different kind of multimedia objects with this keyword search as well. So another thing is the categorization or the classification of the content of these. Again, let's focus on the textual content, but we are not limited. If they are tagged, we can apply this idea to different kind of objects as well, and the interesting objects or the objects related to our project. So let's say we have a collection of documents, and we have a collection of classes like history, economy, planning, and so on. So, but we know these classes, and then what we want to do is the map each of these documents to these classes so that you can organize this content, and you can provide access in an organized way. For instance, you can collect all the articles or the documents related to history, and then anybody who's interested in this label, in this class of documents, can access that collection or that part of the collection. So as a machine learning or as an artificial intelligence problem, classification is labeling the documents or the textual objects with these given labels in an automated way. So again, as an artificial intelligence technique, classification is about building a model so that when you feed, just like you see here, when you have data instances, you give your data to a model, and then it identifies the group, or it tells you which group it belongs to, but these groups are predefined. So this classification is considered or called as a supervised learning technique, again, as an artificial intelligence technique. Why it is supervised learning? Because firstly, you have to provide some instances, some documents with labels so that the machine learning algorithm can learn the groups, what kind of objects are history documents, or what kind of documents are planning documents. So this model is constructed. So in the example or the simple example in the slide is, again, we have documents, but they are English or non-English. So you have to provide a bunch of documents and you have to tell these are English and these are non-English. So there's a teacher there. So training data is like a teacher. And then a model is constructed. So when a new instance comes, when a new document comes, then it can be automatically labeled. So when the collection is, since the collection is like doing it in an automated way without human intervention or without human labeling is something very handy, something very important, which makes the things to make the things faster. Another, again, the artificial intelligence technique to organize the data is called clustering. Here again, we have a bunch of documents, but we don't know the groups. So they are grouped on the basis of their similarity to each other. So as you see in the previous slide on classification, we had the labels, the classes like history, planning, economy, and so on. But here we don't know any labels, but we just let the system, let the algorithm do the grouping. So this is called clustering. So again, as an artificial intelligence technique, let's say we have a bunch of, in our simple example, we have a bunch of travel profiles. And then the clustering algorithm groups these travelers on the basis of their history, traveling history. So George and Patricia, these travelers are similar to each other, so they form a group. Jeff, Evelyn, and Chris is another group, and Rob forms another cluster on its own. But there is no predefined grouping. So on this slide, I want to show you again how we clustered these documents that we collected, as I have mentioned. These articles published by our cost action members are collected, and initially this GLOBE and PCA, these are more technical terms to prepare the data through deep learning techniques. And then we say we want, for instance, 10 groups here. We can change it, but then what happens, into 10 groups, they are organized. So each dot is an article here and different colors. There are 10 colors here and each color is a different cluster. So the same colored articles denote that they are in the same group. They are somehow similar. So in an automated way, we can analyze and try to understand the similarity or the groupings in the data in our article collection on the basis of their own nature. We do not enforce any grouping here. For instance, we click one of them here, which is in the brown group. So this title, I don't know, it belongs to one of our members. Seismic performance assessment of hybrid structures of GIS, of multi-group GIS or DepBoat. So this is one of the articles in our collection. So other browns, then you can identify and click and see which ones are in the same group, in the same cluster. For instance, here we reduce the number of clusters in terms of visuality. So we can turn on and off these clusters. We just keep two of them, these blue and the orange ones, two clusters, and then we can more clearly easily see which ones are in the same group, in the same cluster. And by clicking on the dots again, we can see the title of the papers, and then we can further go to that, if we are interested, go to that paper and access the content. So another capability that we can do, or functionality that we can provide, is sentiment analysis on documents. This is something popularly used in a variety of domains. So sentiment, what is sentiment? Sentiment is a view, attitude, or thought given on the basis of emotion rather than reason. So in sentiment analysis, or also known as opinion mining, which is a natural language processing task, again, an artificial intelligence technique or an artificial intelligence problem, it is about identifying in an automated way, identifying the sentiment given in a piece of text, in a document. So it is the writer is in a positive, expressing a positive mood or a negative mood, or is it just neutral? So given a text, so I have the picture here. Given a text, so documents, you feed it to document to your sentiment analyzer, and the analyzer tells you whether it is positive, neutral, or the sentiment expressed in the text is positive, neutral, or negative. So it is being used in a variety of domains, like customer relations, in marketing, in politics, in social area, in recommendations. So in our case, so I will just pass the techniques, but in our case, we have surveys, we may have some free text, or we may have some comments provided to our project, and then we can, in an automated way, identify the sentiment given to us. So due to the time limitation, I will skip the rest, but there may be some more advanced features like named entity recognition, so identifying the important keywords or important parts of a text, or question answer systems. Okay, we have bunch of a good collection of data and information, documents, pictures. Rather than searching, can we give some question, and then from this collection, can the system automatically answer our question? So this is possible. Like, what is the age of the caves in Göreme? So there are collections, so they are searched, and the answer is extracted. One level behind, beyond, is chatbots, where there's a series of questions and answers. So when a user gives a question, there's an automated answer, but the bot, robot, the software bot behind, can provide further information and further communication. And that's all for now, for my lecture. If you have any questions, you can reach me through my email, especially if you I'm interested in hearing about your comments. What would you like to see in a knowledge base, and what kind of functionalities would you be interested in? Please just tell me through your emails. Thank you.